Welcome to Season 2 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement, and a former Secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, Stephanie Desmon talks to David Putrino of Mount Sinai Hospital in New York, who has been working with so-called COVID-19 long haulers, who remain debilitated after COVID diagnoses months ago. They discuss the long-term symptoms experienced by this group of mostly middle-aged women who are affected by neurological and physical ailments in the wake of what were considered mild infections. Let's listen.
David Putrino, thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me. It's great to be here.
So we're going to talk today about something called long haulers and COVID, and I'd like you to start by explaining to us what that means.
Yeah, absolutely. So we first sort of started to notice that this might be a phenomenon as we were coming out of the first surge that New York City experienced with COVID. We were managing a lot of acute cases using telemedicine and remote patient monitoring. And so what that meant was for around 900 or 1,000 cases of acute COVID, we were checking in with patients on a daily basis and collecting information about symptoms and symptom severity. And as we were sort of coming out of that initial phase, we started to notice that roughly 10 to 15% of the people that we had been monitoring on a daily basis not only weren't getting better at the rate that some of their peers were, but also, we were noticing that they were starting to develop new symptoms. And these new symptoms were not like your classic COVID symptoms. They were, people experiencing cognitive fog, people experiencing difficulties concentrating, a high heart rate, feeling like their heart was pounding in their chest, so this clear palpitation feeling. And then in addition to that, we were getting reports of lots of dizziness, GI symptoms, exercise intolerance, and post-exercise fatigue. The other thing that was really striking about this cohort is that they were much younger than people who were getting very serious COVID signs and symptoms. So our median age was around 43, 44 years old. And a large proportion of the people that we were speaking with were previously fit and healthy. So, around 30 to 40% of the people that we were seeing starting to express these symptoms were I used to run marathons. I don't know what's going on. I shouldn't feel this way. I'm an athlete, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a really puzzling group of individuals that are experiencing these symptoms, and we're trying to get to the bottom of it.
So how do we know this is related to COVID?
It's a fair question. It's just that, this whole cohort of individuals popped up after showing COVID signs and symptoms. I think that from our perspective, we think it's related to COVID simply because we were monitoring these people for COVID infection, and then a large proportion of them started expressing long-term symptoms. Typically, what we would see is, a resolution of the COVID symptoms followed by a few days of feeling fine, up to a week of feeling fine, and then the sort of resumption of these odd long-haul symptoms.
Mm-hmm. And these have been going on now for months in some cases, and they're not resolved. So this, do you know if this, these folks will ever recover?
So we, you know, no promises in the early phases. Mm-hmm. We hope that resolution of the symptoms will be possible. Certainly people are showing signs and symptoms that have been lasting for, you know, many months. So our, you know, our current longest long haulers are people who were sick in March. So, you know, we're, for those people, we're knocking on 5 or 6 months now. And the symptoms that we are seeing, they look like a lot of different things. You know, I'm really, really hesitant to put a label on what we're seeing because every time we put a label on it, someone from some competing illness will say, no, it's not it's not dysautonomia, it's chronic fatigue syndrome. It's not chronic fatigue syndrome, it's, you know, some sort of mast cell activation syndrome, et cetera, et cetera, ad nauseum until, you know, we're hiding in a corner wishing we'd never said anything. So so what I will say is that of every odd and rare immune-mediated syndrome you can think of every odd and rare neuroimmune or neurological syndrome you can think of, I can find you a long hauler that will fit all of the diagnostic criteria. So don't bother arguing with me that it's your condition. I don't care what the name is. So right now we're keeping it non-specific. It is a post-viral syndrome that has, you know, properties of many other post-viral syndromes. We don't know what this is yet, but we have started to treat individuals in a very patient-centric and symptom-centric way. Mm-hmm. And we're starting to have some early success with people who have been enrolled in the program for, a few months. We're mm-hmm. starting to see slight improvements. What we're really aiming for right now is many people are coming to us with highly uncontrolled symptoms. So step one is get the symptoms under control. Step two is make sure that people, once the symptoms are under control, let's have more good days than bad days. Let's get to that point. And then once we're having more good days than bad days, let's start to work to recondition so that you can really feel under control. You can feel, you know, like you have a little bit more say in what you do. The thing that I can share is that in our patients who are responding very well to our interventions, now after 3 or 4 months of intervention, the feedback that's coming back is it's still there. I know it's still there, but I can do things without fear of my symptoms flaring up. So I can, you know, one of the most gratifying responses that we heard was, I can now leave the house without having to think up a plan of what will I do if my symptoms flare up and I have an attack. And so while I still can't promise that people are going to get fully recovered from this, it's really nice to hear some of the people who have been persisting with us from the very beginning that they're getting to a point where they feel in control. And they feel they feel sure that they can handle an attack if it happens out of their home, so much so to the point where they don't feel like they need to obsessively plan every life move, which is, you know, the level of debilitation that many long haulers are feeling. And you know, that's what we're trying, that's the sort of hump that we're trying to get over right now.
Mm-hmm. So these are folks who had what we would consider mild COVID symptoms. Is that correct?
Yeah. You know, I would say mostly that is, mm-hmm. that is correct. I would also say, you know, with full respect to what some of these individuals went through, you know, they did not fit the criteria for hospitalization when New York City was going through a surge. Mm-hmm. But let's be clear, the criteria for hospitalization at that point was, do we think that you're probably going to get intubated? So in many cases, you know, I feel like we're almost leaning too heavily on this sort of only mild COVID symptoms. Certainly, mm-hmm. it's true that many people had, many people were taken aback by the fact that they had COVID, but their symptoms were relatively mild, and then they got hit afterwards with this post-COVID syndrome that is really feels much more severe than their initial acute infection. But also, many of the people that we're working with, they had some pretty, you know, moderate to severe symptoms. It was touch or go whether we admitted them into the hospital. We were tracking their oximetry, and you know, they were having a tough time maintaining good oxygen saturation some days. So there is a spread of severity, and it's probably doing it a disservice to although we want to say mild to moderate just because they didn't end up in the hospital. Mm-hmm. At the time, it was kind of hard to get into the hospital. It was like mm-hmm. Tough thing.
The reason I ask about mild, however, is because I think that a lot of people sort of downplay what happens when you get a mild case, right? Sure. It sounds to me like maybe we need to rethink this whole idea of a mild case, because people maybe aren't taking the risk so seriously. Because I look at this cohort, I understand it's mostly women. Is that right?
Yeah, currently our data suggests primarily women, around 80%.
Yeah. So these women who had mild, so-called mild disease, I mean, look what happened to them. So I think, yeah. I don't know, to me, it's important to point that out, that they weren't hospitalized for the most, you know, these folks weren't hospitalized, and that we all need to still take this really seriously.
Absolutely. And, you know, I think that speaks to how little we know about COVID right now. We've been having some really wonderful conversations with Akiko Iwasaki, who is an amazing immunologist at Yale. And she's been sharing some of her data showing that individuals who had a COVID infection and had a strong immune response, so the strong cytokine response that we've been seeing, women who had that response were more likely to have severe and longer lasting symptoms. Mm-hmm. And so we do think that much of this may be immune mediated. So we're seeing a sort of systemic response to a very, very strong immune response. And for some reason that we don't know yet, that appears to be more likely to occur in women than men. But but Akiko's work is certainly showing that there is some sort of precedent there to show that. So that's an avenue that's a sort of a rabbit hole that we're going down with her right now to try and work out, you know, what that might be. I think that one of the things that she pointed out with her work is that, and that others have also pointed out, is that this cytokine storm can occur regardless of symptom severity. And it can create all of those nasty things like a hypercoagulable state that leads to you throwing clots all over the place, regardless of the conventional symptom severity of, like, you know, coughing up phlegm and difficulty maintaining good oxygen saturation. So you can look more or less fine from that regard, but then you're having a very intense immune response. Your body's going into a hypercoagulable state, and before you know it, you've got clots in your kidneys, and you've got acute kidney damage, or you've got, you know, a clot in your heart, or so on and so forth. So I totally agree that we don't know what a mild disease course looks like right now.
One last question. I was curious. It sounds to me as though you're taking these cases extremely seriously. And I wonder if some of the women who you talk to are concerned that some folks think this is just in their head, that this has been going on so long.
Yes, there's an incredible amount of medical gaslighting going on in this population. There is a lot of issues in treating this sort of a syndrome. We know this from literature in chronic fatigue syndrome. We know this in literature in Lyme disease, in dysautonomia. It will take years to get a diagnosis and then it will take, and then, you know, after those years to get a diagnosis, often it requires not only physical treatment, but psychological treatment to sort of help people begin to trust themselves and their own bodies and their own instincts all over again. And so there's certainly a lot of people being told that they have, that it's what they're experiencing are just panic attacks or anxiety. There's a lot of people being told that it's all in their head and it's a conversion disorder. You know, we have good evidence now that this is very real. I would go as far as to say it's incredibly it's just incredibly incorrect and dangerous to be telling people that just because you haven't heard of something in a brand new global condition that we're learning about every single day. So to physicians, I would say, don't be irresponsible. There are hundreds of thousands of people all over the globe reporting these symptoms. CDC says it's a thing. NHS says it's a thing. World Health Organization says it's a thing. You know, follow it. It's a real thing. Don't tell people they're imagining it.
They're so lucky to have you on their side. Dr. David Putrino, thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me, and thanks for doing what you're doing.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, Stephanie Desmon, and Lamari Morales. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, Cian Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.